Belinda presents this unabridged recording of The Northern Ireland Conflict, A Beginner's Guide, written by Aaron Edwards and Cillian McGrattan, and read by Richard Aspel. A detailed chronology of key events in the Northern Ireland conflict is included at the end of the recording. Note on terminology. The language used to describe the Northern Ireland conflict is often politically loaded, and we have endeavoured to use terms preferred by different groups when describing those groups. For example, while nationalists refer to Northern Ireland's second largest city as Derry, unionists refer to it as Londonderry. Nationalists also often refer to Northern Ireland as the North or the Six Counties. In order to avoid repetition, we have also referred to the conflict as the Troubles, although we acknowledge that this euphemistic colloquialism does not capture adequately the very real suffering endured by many families and individuals. We have used Unionist to refer to the Ulster Unionist and Democratic Unionist parties, and to the government of Northern Ireland, which was controlled by the Ulster Unionist Party from 1921 to 1972. The term Unionist can also refer to the wider political community that favours maintaining constitutional links with the UK. Similarly, the term Nationalists also refers to the political community that favours ending partition. Introduction. For more than a generation, Northern Ireland was a byword for sectarian conflict, terrorism, and civil disobedience. The sound of gunfire and explosions rang out across the world, leading many contemporaries to wonder if the Troubles were truly insoluble. Yet, as we glance back over the course of the past half century, the Northern Ireland conflict cuts a familiar, almost banal silhouette when illuminated against the backdrop of current global and regional instability. While we can debate the finer points of scale, the dark history of this bloody conflict continues to cast a long shadow. Despite this reputation, the Northern Ireland conflict has been transformed beyond violence over the past decade, and especially since a power-sharing administration was formed in 2007 by the region's two dominant, yet diametrically opposing political parties, the Democratic Unionist Party, DUP, and Sinn Féin. Despite the bedding down of the new executive and assembly, there remains some controversy over whether the 1998 Belfast Good Friday Agreement paved the way for this eventual transformation. Political engagement between these once implacable enemies has been played out against a backdrop of fundamental change in the relationships within and between the Unionist and Nationalist communities. The de-escalation of the military dimension of the conflict since the early 1990s certainly added the necessary lubricant to the wheels of what former Prime Minister Tony Blair called the settlement train. But it does not explain why the idea of peace captured the imagination of so many when it did, or how it has lasted for so long. From a conflict which at its height saw up to 30,000 British soldiers deployed on the streets to provide military aid to the civil power, to the ruthless long-running paramilitary campaigns perpetrated by Loyalist and Republican groups, Northern Ireland has since become a model for successful peace and reconciliation processes elsewhere. This book explains what made compromise possible in one of the most bitter and protracted conflicts of modern times. Conflict in Northern Ireland. A familiar story. Between 1966 and 2003, the euphemistically titled Troubles claimed 3,703 lives. Around 40,000 other people were seriously wounded as a direct result of hostilities. Unsurprisingly, given the small population of around 900,000 Protestants and 600,000 Catholics, few people remained untouched by the violence, and intercommunal mistrust, fear, and hatred which marred Northern Ireland society for four decades. Political stalemate persisted during these years as Protestants, who mostly voted for Ulster Unionist political parties, such as the Ulster Unionist Party, UUP, or the DUP, favouring maintaining the constitutional link with the UK, while Catholics, who mostly voted for Irish nationalist parties, such as the Social Democratic and Labour Party, SDLP, and Sinn Féin, aspired to a united Ireland. While the figure of almost 4,000 deaths may appear small when placed in absolute terms against other conflicts, proportionally, it would translate as around 100,000 deaths in the UK or 500,000 in the United States, around 10 times the number of Americans killed in Vietnam. Militant nationalists or Irish Republicans, whose key paramilitary organisation was the Irish Republican Army, IRA, accounted for just under 60% of those deaths. Militant unionists in the form of loyalist paramilitaries accounted for around 30% of the fatalities, while the state security forces, the Royal Ulster Constabulary, RUC, and the British Army contributed to the remainder. As peace takes root, it is undoubtedly becoming difficult for younger generations to appreciate how, for most of the past 40 years, Northern Ireland stood at a crossroads, with the prospect of peace a much more distant option for two communities deeply divided along ethnic, national, religious, cultural, and class lines. Throughout the 1990s, the embryonic peace process was nurtured by community leaders on all sides and at all levels, from statesmen to church leaders, to reformed and reforming paramilitaries, and ordinary people, who found the slaughter of innocent civilians repugnant and wished to do something about it. Many of those who lobbied long and hard for peace had themselves contributed to the armed conflict in the region in more damaging ways through political obfuscation and the manipulation of ethnic sentiments. While they continue to stand firm as implacable enemies, they have now chosen to put aside their differences and engage with one another through the conduit of political dialogue and debate. Politics is not just something that is practiced at the elite level of society by experienced politicians clamouring around a well-polished negotiating table in arcane mansion houses or in the squeaky clean corridors of power in Belfast, London, or elsewhere, but is firmly grounded in the local communities which bore the brunt of the violent conflict. It may be something of a cliché to admit, but US Democratic Speaker of the House of Representatives, Tip O'Neill's famous observation that all politics is local, is nonetheless apt. The intensity of hatred and mistrust in grassroots communities has huge repercussions at a national and international level. This book is also about the complex processes which serve to bring about a transformation in the Northern Ireland conflict and how each level of society contributed to building peace. It focuses on the multi-layered government of the region, from the former Stormont administration run entirely by unionists with the retention of the province within the UK uppermost in the minds of its leaders, to the new power-sharing administration which claims to govern on behalf of all the people. Terrorism, the state, and international security. Curiously, the main parties in conflict have resisted the temptation to label the conflict as a war. Indeed, the DUP successfully passed a motion by 46 votes to 20 in the newly reconstituted Northern Ireland Assembly in 2008, calling on members to recognise that this Assembly repudiates any suggestion that the 30-year terrorist campaign in Northern Ireland be reclassified as a war. As one DUP Assembly member observed in the debating chamber, "We know that the IRA did not fight a war, for they ignored the international conventions that govern warfare." Yet, the principal terrorist groups, such as the IRA and the Ulster Volunteer Force, UVF, did declare war on each other and, in the case of the former, on the British presence in Ireland. Indeed, Irish Republican terrorist groups pioneered in many of the tactics and techniques subsequently utilised by terrorists and insurgents around the globe, including improvised explosive devices, assassinations of government ministers and civilians, the blitzing of commercial centres, as well as naked sectarian killings. Loyalist groups also inflicted heavy casualties on those whom they regarded as their enemy. As with Republicans, in many cases this meant innocent, defenceless civilians. The end of the Cold War, 1989 to 1991, between the rival superpowers of the United States and the Soviet Union, brought with it an upsurge in ethnic quarrels as many former communist satellite states broke away. Yet in more established democracies, where terrorism had been commonplace, the opposite was true. Throughout the 1990s, there was an upsurge in inter-ethnic violence, especially in the Balkans and sub-Saharan Africa, as inter-ethnic, tribal, and clan tensions led to intrastate conflict. Amidst the violence, however, peace processes did take root, if only temporarily, in Israel-Palestine, Northern Ireland, and South Africa. Both Northern Ireland and South Africa became models for the peaceful resolution of protracted violence in other divided societies. Moreover, broader fluctuations in the international arena after the attacks on the United States on the 11th of September 2001 made it less than propitious for groups to employ the indiscriminate method of terrorism to pursue their political goals. The acceptance by the main parties that violence could serve no useful purpose in achieving political goals found more adherence after the end of the Cold War. However, it was to take many more years before peace finally bedded down and a political settlement won over its most vocal opponents. In the context of what Mary Kaldor has called new wars, where differences between cultures, traditions, and beliefs form a major component of division between peoples, the Northern Ireland conflict is far from unique. What distinguishes Northern Ireland from other places plagued by conflict is not that it involves separatist and conservative, or anti- and pro-state groups. Rather, it is the specific coincidence of those factors with the specific decisions and omissions that were made on the ground. The attempts to find a way out of those troubled histories cannot be exported as some sort of skeleton key that will unlock the puzzle of all ethnic, racial, religious, or nationalist quarrels. Just as the conflict emerged and persisted according to the particular way in which various actors responded or omitted to respond, and the methods armed groups utilised to conduct their hostilities, the Northern Ireland peace process should not be seen as a model to be followed. What worked in one context may not work in another. Certainly there are similarities, as this book will endeavour to highlight, between the Irish conflict and those that continue to plague the world today and may continue to do so in the future. However, at its very core, the Northern Ireland conflict is a political one. As in other regions bedeviled by terrorism, insurgency, and state-based violence, a political solution can be found. The Northern Ireland conflict revisited. This book is a historical re-imaging of the Northern Ireland conflict. It uses recently released and otherwise unpublished archival material to revisit what has been a critical period in Anglo-Irish history. This untapped material allows us to question the continued relevance of received wisdom about the conflict. Silencing the voices of those who did not emerge as the dominant players in the aftermath of war and armed conflict has long been the preserve of victors. However, simply repeating tired truisms will not do. An example of this is the oft-repeated quotation from Winston Churchill, who told the House of Commons in 1922 that "Great empires have been overturned. The whole map of Europe has been changed. The position of countries has been violently altered. The modes of thought of men, the whole outlook on affairs, the grouping of parties, all have encountered violent and tremendous changes in the deluge of the world. But as the deluge of the waters subsides and the waters fall short, we see the dreary steeples of Fermanagh and Tyrone emerging once again. The idea that the eruption of violent conflict in Northern Ireland at the end of the 1960s was an inevitable result of centuries-old antagonisms is superficially attractive. What that ethnic explanation fails to do, however, is to say why the violence occurred in the way it did, why it occurred when it did, and why it persisted for over three decades. Furthermore, by continuing blandly to reproduce stories about ethnic antagonisms, there is a risk that the explanations we leave to future generations will simply recycle the stories and the myths that fed the conflict, and thereby postpone a long-hoped-for resolution. This book is the result of a deliberate historical and political choice made by the authors to avoid recourse to stories about ancient ethno-nationalist antagonisms, and instead to concentrate on the historical and political choices made during the conflict. It takes a broad chronological approach, exploring several themes and events with references to the most up-to-date thinking and research on the Troubles in Ireland. Chapter 1 explains the background to the conflict from the formation of the Northern Ireland state in the early 1920s. It details the nature of Unionist Party authority in the region, its main opponents, and how challenges by the paramilitary campaigns led to the unravelling of the state by 1972. Chapter 2 looks at the aftermath of the British government's intervention and the subsequent attempt to try to set up a devolved power-sharing administration in the form of the short-lived Sunningdale Executive. Chapter 3 examines the entrenchment of the division in the late 1970s and the increasingly intergovernmental approach of the 1980s. Chapter 4 looks at the aftermath of the 1985 Anglo-Irish Agreement and the beginnings of the peace process. Chapter 5 investigates the political deadlock that set in almost immediately following the signing of the Good Friday Agreement and asks, in the absence of institutional compromise, how did local communities deal with the vacuum caused by this stalemate? It argues that, above all, the institutional stalemate left community relations practitioners to manage conflict on the interfaces where antagonism was at its sharpest.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.